Good morning, First Baptist. I'm Nancy.
And I'm Barbara. Thank you for joining us in worship this morning.
College Supper is back tonight. College students, make sure to join us from 7 to 8 in the Fellowship Hall.
FBC is leading a construction trip to El Salvador to build small homes for a few families that need them. The trip dates are February 24th through March 2nd. Interested? Join us for the informational meeting this Wednesday at 7 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. For more information, call the church office.
Celebrate joy in January, ladies, at First Baptist Bolivar this Friday. Join in and bring soup, salad, or bread to share a time of fellowship. For dessert, the chocolate fountain is back with lots of dipping delights. A representative from Community Outreach Ministries will share with us how that we can bring joy to our community.
Women's Tuesday night Bible study begins January 30th. We will study the opening chapters of Genesis and the fundamental truths they teach us about God. We watch Him bring light after darkness, order after chaos, and rest after toil, all through the power of His Word. Join us for 10 sessions of verse-by-verse study as we dive into Genesis 1 through 11. Workbooks will be available the first night for $17. Child care is available with registration. Ladies, make sure to register for both of these impactful events at fbcbolivar.org/events.
The Super Bowl is back. Our second graders host this event each year, and our goal is for 2,024 cans of soup. Please bring cans of soup to the church lobbies, the third floor children's area, or the office by February the 11th. If you like to donate money, make sure to make your check out for Super Bowl. All soup goes to support the local food pantry.
Parents, due to the weather, we moved our Kids International Missions Night to this Wednesday. See you there at 6 p.m.
If this is your first time in worship with us, we invite you to text the word GUEST to 417-282-8322. You can also visit our info hubs after the service where we can meet you and help you to connect with First Baptist. Have a great day in worship.
Good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Bolivar. We're so glad you're here today. We want to welcome those who are watching online or listening on the radio as well. Reading from Psalm 100, verses 1 through 5. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into His presence with singing. Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. Let's stand together as we sing, Who You Say I Am.
Child of God, yes I am. My name is Julie Duvall, and I am the Director of Children's Ministry here at First Baptist Church. And this morning, we get to do our parent-child dedication. It's always a joy to see all of these children and the blessings that they are to us. And so I'm going to take a moment and introduce you to all of them, and then Pastor Mike is going to lead them in dedication. All right, so starting on this side, we have Jeremiah Buddy Kavnis, and his name means Yahweh will exalt. Jeremiah was born on November 30th, 2023, and his parents are Joshua and Ashley Kavnis. Next, we have Avery Valentine Davis, and her name means wise. She is born March 18th of 2023, and her parents are Logan and Catherine Davis. Next, we have Leland Emmett Four, and his name means meadowland or fallow land in the Old English. And he was born September 19th, 2023. His parents are Shauna and Daniel Four, and his sister is Ada. Next, we have Gabriella Tate Stretch, and Gabriella's name means God is my strength. Her birthday is August 8th, 2023, and her parents are Brianna and Nicholas Stretch. Her siblings are Carter, Amelia, and Gideon. Next, we have the Taylor family. We have Jetson Theo Taylor, and his name means compassionate. He was born May 9th, 2023, and we have Sutton Claude Taylor, dad's holding Sutton. His name is from the Southern Homestead, and he was born June 25th, 2020, and their parents are Jacob and Caitlin Taylor.
I want to give this group a round of applause. Well, today's a special day as we have these families up here, and today is really a dedication of the children, but of the parents. You are embarking on one of the most important roles, really, of your life. One of the biggest journeys that you'll have is raising up these kids, and we desire to do it in the way of the Lord. You know, we want your kids to follow God's guidance for their lives. Ultimately, we want them to come to know Him as a Savior. You're not doing it alone. We are doing it collectively as a church. We all come together to help inspire and influence and guide our kids to come to know Christ and to grow in Him. So we do this collectively. Parents, I'm going to read several covenant-type statements, and as we do this, if you agree, you can say, "We do." So parents, do you come today recognizing your child is a gift from God? And with thankful hearts, do you dedicate them to the Lord? And if so, say, "We do." We do. Okay. Do you pledge as parents to bring up your child in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? I do. Believing that it is in the home that the child should come to love the Bible, worship, and discover the Lordship of Christ, do you dedicate yourselves to Christian parenthood? I do. Do you recognize that not one of us is sufficient for the responsibilities of parenthood without the aid of God's grace in partnership with the church? We do. We do. Well, church, again, we are in it together. So if you would stand, we're going to have a time of covenant for us as a church body with these parents and these families as we work together. Church, I'm going to read this statement, and if you agree, you can say, "We will." Do you, as members of First Baptist Church, realize this is your child also? Are you willing to provide the kind of church which will contribute to their spiritual maturity? Are you willing to pray, to witness, to encourage, and to teach these children and their parents how to continue to grow in the Lord? And will you do all that is in your power to strengthen this covenant through example and to support this family through prayer as they guide and direct their child? And if so, say, "We will." All right, let's pray together. Let's pray together. Father, we appreciate your amazing blessings of children and of family. Father, we ask you to be with these children today, that God, that you will move on their lives, your Holy Spirit will work, and they will come to know you as their Savior. God, be with these parents today. They want very, very much to raise their child in the way of the Lord. They want to care for them and love them and protect them and help them grow the way you would want them to do. God, give them wisdom. God, give them guidance. Give them insight. And help them to know they're not doing it alone. We are in this together. So, God, we appreciate the many blessings that you provide for us every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Give them one more round of applause as they exit today.
Let's remain standing. Let's remain standing as we sing "By Faith."
Those who prove his faith. Father God, thank you. You are gracious and compassionate. You're slow to anger and abounding in love, kind, faithful love. Father God, as we go about our work week to week, Lord, we pray that we would partner with you to bring your life and your good into the world around us. As we rest today, we pray that we would rest in all you've done for us, all you've accomplished for us. Father, as we use the money that you've given us, we pray that we would use it to bring your peace and your hope, your stability, your justice. Father God, I pray that you would make us generous people who don't live in worry, but live in trust, that we would trust your goodness. In Jesus' name, amen.
Reading from John chapter 21, verses 15 through 19. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." He said to him a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted, but when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go." This he said to show by what kind of death he was to glorify God. And after saying this, he said to him, "Follow me." Let's stand together as we sing, "Come Thou Fount, Come Thou King."
Come Thou Fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing Thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnets, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I fixed upon it, mount of Thy redeeming love. I was lost in utter darkness, till You came and rescued me. I was found by all my sin when Your love came and set me free. Now my soul can sing a new song. Now my heart has found a home. Now Your grace is always with me, and I'll never be alone.
Yeah.
The new year is often a time of reflection, a chance to look back on the past 365 days and remember. Sometimes the memories bring a smile, and other times they break our hearts. Chances are you've experienced a bit of both this past year. The new year is also a time to look ahead, to imagine what could be, to scan the horizon with expectation, and seek God's guiding hand. It's a time to strive for better, to live louder, love stronger, and be more of who God has created us to be. It's an opportunity for new beginnings, a chance to start fresh, to pursue God with a renewed passion, and to press on with all our hearts. The truth is, God has been faithful this past year, and that faithfulness promises to carry us through the next. As a new year begins, may we remember this one simple truth. In Christ, we are a new creation. The old is gone, and the new has come.
Today, you agree?
Absolutely. It has been a good year. A little chilly. I think warm days are ahead. I'm looking forward to that. Hey, glad to be with you today. My name's Mike, in case we haven't met. I'm filling in for Adam today. Adam and the South Asia team, they landed on the field this past week, and they are hard at it. They are meeting with pastors, teachers, and leaders. They're spending time at the Bible College, getting some of the updates, seeing some of the new buildings. They are doing a lot of preaching. They're doing a lot of teaching. They're facilitating evangelism training. They're doing a lot of great things, meeting with students, meeting with people, meeting with partners. So you just pray for them as they press on. They are going to be back, I believe, on Friday, and Adam will be right back here next Sunday. So you can be praying for them. Hey, when I first started off in ministry, I was a youth pastor. I was a youth pastor for about 8 years. And I really enjoyed spending time with students and their families, trying to equip them and resource them, challenge them to make a difference on their campus and in their community. Really enjoyed all those things. But I also enjoyed the games, you know. And a lot of my games involve food. So like the classic blender game, you know. You take like a frog leg, throw it in, little dash of hot sauce, maybe put in some head cheese, put that all in the blender, mix that up. And then it really comes down to, you know, what student can eat or drink the most of that concoction. That was a fun game to play. You know, a little earlier on, I played the raw egg eating contest. Not sure why. But the winner ate 11 eggs. The next day, his mom called. And she said, hey, my son has spent a good bit of time in the bathroom last night, so I don't know if the raw egg eating contest is really a good idea. So I thought to myself, but didn't say out loud, well, you know, Rocky Balboa didn't have any problem with raw eggs. So apparently your son will not be the boxing heavyweight champion of the world. So we established that. Hey, I didn't always make the right decisions with my game choices. There's a lot of things out of the gate that I didn't do well, or I could have done better. And I realized pretty early on that I needed some help. I needed some people to guide me along. I needed some wisdom and some counsel and some direction. And I was fortunate to have a couple guys in my life that really mentored me along as I was trying to get out of the gate in ministry. Well, one of those guys was Ken Mackin. Ken was my first pastor when I was in St. Joseph, Missouri. And Ken helped me in a lot of ways, but he talked to me about the logistics of ministry. You know, how to organize a student ministry worship night, the value of small groups and ministry in the community and in mission trips. He talked to me about how to be involved, you know, what to do with weddings and funerals. And he allowed me to do a role in those. Maybe it was just reading a scripture or saying a prayer, but he involved me, and he helped me get acquainted with how those worked. And then later on, I was doing those on my own. you know, baptisms and preaching, all the things that you do in ministry, he let me have a shot and have a chance, and he gave me input and direction. He gave me some suggestions of what to do. Man, I really appreciate Ken doing all those things when I first was getting started. It meant a lot to me. Another guy in my life about that same time was Joey Butler. He was a pastor in Blue Springs, Missouri. Joey really talked to me about the heart of ministry. You know, Joey loved people, and he really wanted people to come to know the Lord and be in relationship with Jesus. And he didn't want them just to know about Jesus. He wanted them to be in relationship with Jesus in a close, intimate way. He wanted them to live out that faith in a way that glorified God. He was passionate about that. And I really appreciate Joey helping me in those areas. You know, I needed guys like that that could speak into my life, that could give me a little bit of insight, guys that were available to me that I could ask questions of. And they'd give me some correction. They'd give me some suggestions. They would help me along. But man, I appreciate it, and I really needed those guys in my life, and ultimately, they gave me a vision of what ministry could be, because I had a call on my life, and those guys helped me live out that call. Let me tell you today that everybody in this room today has a call on your life. Jesus has a ministry and a mission for you, and a big part of that is he wants us to know him, to love him, to follow him, to be in relationship with him. He wants that, but he wants to use us to minister and to do ministry with the people around us in our sphere of influence. You know, my sphere of influence is going to be different than your sphere of influence, in your sphere of influence, in your sphere of influence. Everybody in this room, you are around people on some extent, in some way, probably different than I am. It takes all of us together to communicate the gospel. God wants to use every one of us to model, through the power of the Holy Spirit, what it looks like to be in relationship with him and to live life that glorifies him. God's going to use us all. A question we might have was, how can we do that? You think God can really use me to do something like that? Can he use me to help others to follow him? And the answer is, he can. I don't know about all the excuses you may have in your mind right now that are going through, but he can blow past all of those things, and he can and does and will use you to reach people. God desires us to live lives that help other people follow him. So this morning I want to take a look just at a few snapshots in the life of Peter, in some of the interactions that he and Jesus had as Jesus was developing him to be the follower and the shepherd and the caregiver and the leader that he became. And I think developed is a pretty good word, at least for me, because Peter had a lot of rough edges. Peter didn't have it all figured out. And I think, boy, if God could do something in the life of Peter, he could do something in my life and yours. So the first snapshot is going to be Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4, verses 18, 19, and 20. And in this first snapshot, we're going to see that Jesus called Peter. So while walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Jesus did, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. You know, there's a lot of titles that we could give to Jesus that are all true. He is Savior, he is King, he is Lord, but he is a great developer of people. He called Peter, but he called him into relationship, and relationship is key. Many, many good things happen in the context of relationship and spending time together. You know, I've always found Peter to be kind of an interesting guy. You know, he was a fisherman. He was a hard-working, seemingly regular guy. But he was one of the first guys that Jesus called to follow him, to be his disciple. Later on, Peter would be the spokesman of the 12 disciples. He is an apostle. He's a leader of the early church. He was the first Christian missionary to the Gentiles, a Christian missionary to the Jews, and a Christian martyr in Rome. Very passionate. He was a man of action. But many times his heart got in front of his head. we see him now, at least I do, as being a hero of the faith. He didn't get it right all the time. Peter wasn't a guy that had it all figured out. But in spite of all of that, Jesus called Peter to follow, to be in relationship with him, and Jesus transformed his life. Jesus led Peter, but at the same time, he walked alongside of Peter to give him a clear picture of what it really meant to live and to die for the gospel. What we see here in Matthew 4:19 specifically is Jesus gave Peter a vision for the purpose and mission of his life. He said, "Follow me, and Jesus is going to lead. I will make you, and Jesus is going to transform him. Fishers of men." And he's going to give him a vision and a purpose for his life. And he has that same hope for all of us. You know, this morning there's a lot of stages in life, a lot of seasons of life represented. Maybe today we have a high school student or a middle school student, and God wants to use you to impact your campus, your classroom, and your team. You may be a college student, maybe you're a young professional, maybe you're newly married, you're a new parent, you're single, or you're single again, an empty nester like me. Or maybe you're a seasoned senior. All these stages of life, all these seasons of life, through all the big decisions, through all the two steps forward and the one step back, through the questions and the confusion, and through all the highs and the lows, Jesus wants a relationship with us. He wants to transform our lives. He wants to lead us to a mission of life in our life and in the community. He wants us to live life that glorifies him. So Jesus called Peter, but he also guided Peter. He guided Peter. We look at Matthew 14. We're going to look at 28 through 30 through 33. Now, kind of leading up to this, this is where Peter is walking on water. Okay, Jesus called him out of the boat. He walks on the water, at least just for a little bit, you know. And leading up to this passage, the feeding of the 5,000 had just taken place. The disciples were getting into a boat, and they were going across the sea, and Jesus hung back for a little while. But in the middle of the night, Jesus comes to them. He's walking on the water. He's walking on the waves. It's the middle of the night. Of course, the disciples were startled. They were afraid. And he says, "Take heart. Don't be afraid." And I think about, man, I'm hearing the words come out of your mouth, Jesus. But I don't know if I'm feeling that in the middle of the night. Somebody's walking on water. Here comes Peter. Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and he walked on water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." And Jesus immediately reached out his hand, took hold of him, saying to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got back into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." You know, Jesus was really all about on-the-job training. You know, he called Peter out of the boat. Peter got out, and he did walk on water for a little bit. But his faith was weak. His faith needed to grow. And I think when people are thinking about Peter, it's easy to just say, hey, you know, Peter was kind of brash. He just kind of bumbled around a little bit. He had some over-passionate missteps that he took. Again, heart before his head. But man, nobody could deny the fact that Peter loved Jesus. And he demonstrated a growing trust and a growing faith, and he had courage that you can't help but commend. He walked on the water. What is Jesus thinking in this moment in time? He's walking across the waves and the water, and he calls out. He sees Peter get out of the boat. What's going through Jesus' mind? Okay, look at this guy. He is giving it a shot. I appreciate that. He was willing to get out of the boat. But in the end, in the totality of this passage, we see another example of Peter's weakness and Jesus' strength that ultimately led to the proclamation of truly, this is the Son of God. You ever think that in your own life? You come across lots of twists and turns in life, a lot of ups and downs, and it's challenging, and you see yourself in a state of weakness. And then in that moment in time, Jesus meets us with his strength in the moment, and we're left kind of in awe. Truly, this is the Son of God. You know, Jesus came to seek and save the lost. He came down to us. He lived the perfect, sinless life. He paid the debt for our sin by dying. He died on the cross. He was buried. Then 3 days later, he rose again, and he demonstrates the fact that he has power over sin and over death. My sin, your sin, in all the ways that we've tried to fix it, all the ways that we've tried to accommodate our life to make it work out, he has more power than all of those things, and he truly is the answer to all those problems, and he's the answer to our sin. He wants to transform us, everybody in this room, but he wants to transform all of us, all the pieces of our life, every area of our life, and ultimately, it's for our good, and it's for his glory. And man, I hope today you see that as being good news. We can have hope. We can be forgiven. We can be changed and transformed. We can be right with God. I promise there's so many people out in our community right now that they're thinking, man, is there any hope for me? My life is such a wreck. I've made so many bad decisions. Can I really be right? Can my life be transformed? Can I be forgiven? You may be sitting here right now in your seat thinking those very same things. Can God really use me if he knows who I really am? The answer is he can, because that good news impacts all aspects of our life. It impacts our relationships. It impacts the relationships we have with family and friends, our budgets, our problems, and our plans. It is good news. Jesus and his word has something to say about every single aspect of our lives, and he wants us to know that we can trust him. We can trust him. We see another snapshot in the life of Peter, and it's in John 21. We're going to look at chapter 21, verses 15, 16, and 17, and then later on we're going to look at a few more verses as we look at the next snapshot. Jesus called Peter, called him to follow, called him to relationship. He guided Peter as Peter was taking some of those first steps, getting started, and he cared about Peter. You know, as we're looking at John 21, John, the 21st chapter is the last chapter in the book of John. There's a lot of things that led up to that chapter. There's a lot of things that happened in a very short period of time. You know, Jesus and his disciples had a final meal together. Jesus demonstrated the depth of what it meant to really serve each other when he washed the disciples' feet. He was foreshadowing what was to come. He prayed for them. He was betrayed by Judas. He was arrested. There was a mock trial. In the midst of all those things, Peter denied Jesus 3 times. Jesus was crucified. He was buried. He was resurrected. And he began to appear to some, actually many of his disciples. And that gets us up to where we are right now in John 21, where Jesus is talking with Peter on the beach. Verse 15. And when they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" And he said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus said to him, "Then feed my lambs." And he said to him a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And he said, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus said to him, "Then tend my sheep." And Jesus said to Peter a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter was grieved because he said this to him a third time, "Do you love me?" And he said, "Lord, you know everything. You know I love you." And Jesus said to him, "Then feed my sheep." There's a guy who writes books. He has made some comments on this topic. His name is Bruce Barton, and he makes this comment about those verses. He said, after the meal, Jesus and Peter had a talk, and during their conversation, Jesus led Peter through an experience that would remove the cloud of guilt that came from Peter's denial. Jesus conveyed both forgiveness and usefulness to this disciple who must have concluded he was beyond being useful to Jesus. Took away the cloud of guilt. forgiveness, reinstatement, redemption, a statement of usefulness. How many times in our life have we needed that from Jesus? And he brings it. I mean, much can be said about these verses. We can look at it from a lot of different angles here. But what I want us to see today is Jesus cared about Peter. He restored, he reinstated Peter after failure. Jesus gave Peter encouragement. It was both tough and tender. And it was all done to prepare him for the mission that lie ahead for Peter. You know, today, if you failed, if you've gotten off track from what Jesus wants for you and your life, I want you to know today that he cares for you. And redemption is available to you through Jesus. It's true. You know, this morning, God may want to use you to help somebody else who feels that same way. Can my life be salvaged? He may want to use you to help somebody to know in their head and in their heart that their life can be redeemed. That's a message that you could share to your circle of influence. But we also see there's a fourth snapshot. We're going to press on in John 21. We see that Jesus has called Peter and called him to follow. He's called him to relationship. He's guided Peter. He's cared about Peter. We also see that Jesus is commissioning Peter. And we're going to overlap a little bit. We're going to go back and reread 17. Then we're going to go 18 and 19 in John 21. Jesus said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter was just grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." And Jesus said to him, "Then feed my sheep. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself, walk wherever you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go." This he said to show by what kind of death he was to glorify God. And after saying this, he said to him one more time, what a great reminder, "Follow me." Jesus asked Peter to take a specific action. He said, "Feed and take care of my sheep." You know, leading in ministry is way more than just being a pastor. All of us today are leading in ministry. We have the opportunity, no matter where we are, the places you go, the places you frequent, your sphere of influence, we have the opportunity to minister to people in the name of Jesus and for the gospel. Leadership in ministry requires a servant's heart, that we are willing to help and develop people. It takes conviction. It takes compassion. Peter lived out this commission on his life, and he became a dedicated shepherd of the flock. You know, in John 21, this reinstatement of Jesus in the life of Peter really is a way, so many things here, but it was also a vote of confidence almost from Jesus to say, "You will be a leading voice for me in the early church, and I have confidence in you." You know, Luke, who is also not only the Gospel of Luke, but he also authors the book of Acts, he lists off many things that Peter was involved in, he was active in the early church. Peter was a bold proclaimer of the gospel. Through the power of the Holy Spirit in and through his life, he was a miracle worker. He was an authoritative figure in the church. And as we mentioned before, he was the first missionary to the Gentiles, a missionary to the Jews outside of Jerusalem. Not too bad for a guy that was broken and felt like, "I'm useless. Can Jesus use me?" God redeemed his life, and he can redeem your life today. The passage ends with Jesus telling and reminding Peter, "Follow me." Ultimately, Peter demonstrated that by total devotion as he was martyred. He had died a martyr's death in Rome. You know, leading people, helping them grow, developing them, always has a cost. It costs time. It costs energy. Sometimes it can cost some money. But it always pays off because we're sharing wisdom and experience, and we're meeting needs emotionally, physically, and almost always spiritually. Being willing to seek out wisdom is super important and sometimes can require humility, that we would humble ourselves to reach out to someone else and say, hey, can you help me with this thing in my life? But together, it's going to lead to maturity, a broader perspective, and some spiritual growth. At the end of the day, what I'm hoping for today is what we see from Jesus and Peter. He called him to follow. He called him to relationship. He guided him. He cared for him, and he commissioned him. Together, Jesus is modeling how you and I can help one another follow Jesus and live a life that glorifies him. We are going to be growing together, and it's necessary because people need relationships. They need wisdom. They need care. They need hope. And we can help people in those things. True wisdom is always going to begin with a relationship with Jesus. That's where it starts. Again, he came down. He died for our sins. He was buried. He rose from the grave. He is calling us to turn from our sin, to repent, to turn to him. He says he'll save us. He'll make us new. And that's where real life begins. We have the opportunity to help others to know him. We have the opportunity to seek and receive help to grow in wisdom, to live out these things that, of the Christian life. You know, the last 2 weeks, 2 weeks ago, Adam started a series. You know, First Baptist, what's the strategic plan for the next 5 years? You know, 2 weeks ago, he talked about local ministry and missions, and last week he talked about equipping for cultural engagement. And today we're really talking about what are some of the key factors involved in walking alongside of somebody, mentoring them. I told you at the beginning, I had these two guys that really made a huge impact in my life, and I needed them to help me. Mentoring is discipleship. It's just maybe more specifically targeted about a season of life or a stage of life or an opportunity or a challenge. You know, around this room is a lot of experience for how God has worked in and through your life. Around this room is a lot of questions for God. I have these things going on. I sure wish I knew how I could proceed forward. I sure wish I had somebody to help me. That's all happening in this room right now. Lots of stages of life. We've already covered that. We have lots of opportunities that come our way. I'm a high school student. I'm a college student. It's my first job. It's my first budget. I'm single. I'm single again. I plan to be married, or help, I'm married. I'm navigating parenting. I'm empty nesting. I'm retiring. We need each other. Mentoring is discipleship, maybe more specifically targeted. We're in the early stages of trying to lay out what are some of the guidelines that would help people make connections to say, hey, I need somebody to walk with, and hey, I'm willing to walk with somebody. We're in those kind of early stages. How do we do it? But I'm telling you what, I understand for years and years, people have been in mentoring relationships here at First Baptist. You've probably walked with many people. You've prayed with them. You've had a cup of coffee with them. You've opened the Bible together with them. You've counseled them. Many times have you went to somebody and say, hey, I'm really having this thing. I've got this opportunity. I have this need. Can you help me? Can you give me some guidance? At the end of the day, we're drawing it back to what does God have to say about life? You pick a topic. God has something to say about life, about your life, the things that you're going through, the needs that you have. We can help each other. We just want to provide clear means of connection is the goal. Working with several people, trying to figure out what does all that look like, because we don't really want it to be a program. We just want to help people get connected. What's some things we should be aware of? Billy and Regina Russell, Donna Lene Hodson, my wife and I, Julie Duvall, Ben Solomon, Abby Rhodes, Jed Bond. We got lots of stages of life covered there. What should we be mindful of as we are putting these together? We also know the importance of our singles ministry and our college ministry. You know, weeks ago, you may remember Michael Green. We voted on him to become our college pastor. Today, Michael is preaching his last message at the church that he pastors in Arizona. He'll be hopping in a truck tomorrow. He's going to begin to make his way. And he plans to be in town on Thursday, where he's going to begin to unpack. He'll be on campus next Sunday right here. And then next, the following Wednesday, the 31st, he'll preach his first collective service. But he's around the corner. Be praying for Michael Green as we keep on ministering to our college students. You know, in the late spring, we were so blessed to have Ian and Jenny Nix be willing to take on a singles group, and we appreciated them. They did a lot of good work, made a lot of connections, invested into a lot of lives. And as times went on, scheduling and all these things, I think they feel like maybe they need to step back from that at this point. So we've reached out to Brandon and Jen Weesey, and they are going to take the mantle now. They are going to take the baton and have a group on their at their house on Tuesday nights at 6 o'clock to meet with singles, and that's going to be a great, great opportunity. Be praying for Brandon and Jen. You know, this summer my wife and I will be married 28 years, and about 3 years down the road of being married, we had our first child, and we had, you know, every 2 years we had another child, and somewhere in there we're just like, man, God, we want to do a good job raising these kids, and we want to do it in a way that honors you. And you know, we had great parents on both sides. Man, I appreciate my mom and dad. Shondi's parents are great. They've given us great counsel and advice. We just wanted to raise them in the way of the Lord. We found another couple in our church, Kent and Mary Warner. It really helped us. Their kids were further along than us. They were in high school and middle school. And all that was going well for them, despite their youth pastor, which was me. And I was past the raw eggs by then. You know, I was doing a home run derby in the worship center, you know, doing Nerf balls. I see nobody likes that. That's fine. It was still fun. Hey, you know what? We met with them. We sought them out. We wanted their wisdom and their advice. We needed to grab a few pages out of their playbook to say, you are obviously doing something here. Can we learn a little bit from you? They helped us immensely. They were available to us. They answered our questions. We knew they prayed for us. They were available to us. We can do that here. You're coming from a lot of different places in life. We have people that are beginning various things in life. We can make some connections about mentoring, about how we can help each other along. Because we want to grow together. We want to know Jesus more. We want to follow him more closely. We want to glorify him in all the areas of our life. We want those things. You know, this morning as we conclude, you may have something on your heart today, and you're like, Mike, this thing, it's really been a struggle for me. I'd be happy to pray for you. Somebody would be happy to pray for you today. You say, hey, I have this new opportunity, this new thing that would advance me in here and here, this new opportunity for my family. I'm really excited about it, but would you pray for that? And I'm happy to. Maybe this morning God is leading you to take a chance. Make yourself available. Take a chance. Maybe reach out to somebody for help. Let us know. Again, we're on the beginning of stages, but we want to help people make connections together. It's important. We can do it together. Let's pray as we conclude today. Well, Father, we really appreciate you. God, thank you for loving us so deeply, sacrificing so much. I thank you for the people that have spoken to my life, the Ken Mackins, the Joey Butlers, the Kent and Mary Warners, that have really helped me along the way. God, a little further down the road, I thank you, Lord, for the people you have put in my kids' lives, to talk to them, to instruct them, to give them wisdom, to give them guidance, give them insight. God, thank you for helping my kids as well. I think about all the people that I know, the friends that I have that are wanting so desperately to follow the Lord in a faithful way. Maybe they just need someone to visit with, to talk to. God, help us to be willing to reach out, to be willing to help. God, we appreciate all you're doing in and through us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together as we sing, Lord, I need you.
Without you, I fall.
Before we leave, if you have any questions, we'd like to talk to a pastor. We definitely want to have those conversations. We can do that face-to-face, or you could text the word CONNECT to the number on the screen, 417-282-8322. We can make an appointment to talk about those things this week, whether it's following Jesus or being baptized or joining First Baptist. We want to have those conversations with you. Also, Mike Knight will be out in the lobby after the service. If you're not in a core group already, we want you to find one, and he'll be out there to meet with you and help you find one that would be perfect for you. So please take time to stop and talk to Mike if you need a core group. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day that we could be here and worship today, Lord. And we do thank you for those who have mentored us in our spiritual walk, Lord. And we also pray that you would open our eyes to see opportunities for us to mentor others, Lord. Help us to grow closer to you and help us to help others grow closer to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.